the Society on behalf of EduRekha, and I welcome you to this session on PostgreSQL tutorial for beginners. So in this session, guys, we'll mainly focus on the different concepts related to PostgreSQL. So by the end of the session, I can guarantee you the fact that, you know, you'll get a complete understanding of the different concepts and the commands that you can use to start using and playing with your data and the databases in PostgreSQL. So without wasting any further time, let's take a look at the topics for today's session. So we'll start today's session by understanding what is database management systems and then what exactly is SQL. After that, I'll talk about what is PostgreSQL and its features, and then I'll show you how you can install PostgreSQL in Windows. Once you're done with that, I'll talk about the different command categories in SQL, that is the DDL, DML, DCL, and DCL, so that you can understand how you can implement various commands to manipulate your databases and how you can control privileges or maybe create your own databases. Apart from these commands, I'll also talk about various other concepts like, you know, entity relationship diagrams, operators, aggregate functions, joins, normalizations, views, triggers, procedures, and so on. So I hope the agenda is clear. So it's really simple. We're going to get a complete understanding. So let's just get started with it. Now, before I move on with this session, I would like to request all of you to subscribe to our EduRekha YouTube channel to get daily notified on the top trending technologies in today's market to scale up your career as you wish. So now, on that note, let's get started with the first topic for today's session. That is, what is database management system? Now, all of you might be very familiar with the term data, right? We all know that, you know, around 2.5 quintillion bytes of data gets generated every day, either based on your social media or maybe you're working in a company, enterprises, or maybe on an individual basis also, right? There's so much of amount of data present every day, but how do you think all this data gets managed and where do you store these data? Well, obviously to the fact you store data in databases and then you manage them with the help of the database management systems, right? Well, that is where database management systems come into picture. Whenever you have a lot of amount of data and then you wish to manage the data according to your own needs so that you can generate meaningful results, then that's where database management system comes into picture. Now, there are mainly four types of database management systems that you need to understand about. That is the hierarchical database management systems, the network database management systems, the relational database management systems, and the object-oriented database management systems. Now, talking about hierarchical database management systems. So in the hierarchical database management system, what happens is that all the data is present in a hierarchical form. So you can understand with the help of a flowchart, maybe, or, you know, you understand the term of hierarchical, right? You have A, and then maybe the node A can have two more childs, and maybe those two childs can have further lot of data, right? So basically, it's a form of a hierarchical. So every data present in the lower form must be related to the higher form in one or the other way. Coming to network database management system, the network database management system has databases in the form of a network. So you can basically connect data with each other in the form of a network. Coming to relational database management systems, the relational database management systems are in the form of a table. So you have a lot of number of tables related to each other. So basically, if you take the example of MySQL, then you must be knowing to the fact, right? You know, there are a few tables and then all those tables can be interrelated to each other, right? Coming to object-oriented database management systems. So basically, this particular database management system is basically an object database in database management system in which information is represented in the form of the objects as used in the object-oriented programming, right? So basically, whenever your information, or you can say that, you know, the data values is represented in the form of the objects, then it is object-oriented database management system. So guys, these were the basically four types of database management systems. That is the hierarchical database management system, the network, the relational, and the object-oriented database management systems. So now that you know what is database and maybe, you know, database management systems and the different types of it, let's next look into what is SQL. Now, all of you might have heard the term SQL, right? Well, SQL, or most commonly known as Structured Query Language, is basically a standardized programming language which is used for managing the relational databases. So basically, with SQL, you can modify databases, add, update, or delete rows of data, also retrieve subsets of information from a database, and do many more actions. Apart from this, relational databases like MySQL database, Oracle, MS SQL Server, Sybase, etc., even PostgreSQL use SQL as its base to, you know, build up their own programming language and make the world use it. And finally, queries and other SQL operations in SQL are basically written as statements. You can have a create statement, a delete statement, maybe a select, insert, add, update, and so on statements, right? So if you have to understand SQL, guys, it's really simple. SQL is a structured query language. which is like the base to all the programming languages related to databases, so that you can use them further to handle your databases. So now that you know what exactly is SQL, let's look into the main topic for today's session. That is, what is PostgreSQL? Now, PostgreSQL is an open source object relational database system with 30 plus years of active development in the industry. So basically, if you have to understand PostgreSQL, guys, PostgreSQL is basically a programming language, or maybe you can understand that, you know, a language through which you can handle open source relational database systems and then handle databases. PostgreSQL is world's most advanced open source relational database. So guys, this is a really great topic to start learning about databases. So if I have to just define PostgreSQL for you, then you have to understand just 2 points over here, that it is open source and it is used for handling databases in the form of object relational database system. So the data present in the form of relational database, but yes, it is object oriented. That's where PostgreSQL comes into picture. Now, since PostgreSQL is so popular in the industry, next, let's look into the features of PostgreSQL. So the features of PostgreSQL are, as you can see on my screen, that is basically the data types, the data integrity, performance, reliability, security, and extensibility. So talking about data types, when I say data types, what I mean by that is PostgreSQL provides various kinds of data types to store data in any format, such as, you know, integer, numeric, data type, JSON, XML file, maybe in the form also of point, line, circle, polygon, and also you can have custom data types. So there are various kinds of data types, like, you know, the primitive one, the structure, the document, geometry, and customizations. So we'll not get into the depth of, you know, the different data types related to PostgreSQL. You can go to their official document and check what are the different data types that, you know, PostgreSQL provides. Well, I would leave that to you. Moving on to the next feature, data integrity. So when I say data integrity, what I mean by that is, you know, your data is secured. So basically, whatever data that you have, it's made sure that, you know, there's no redundancy, and then it's stored in the proper format with the help of, you know, various constraints and keys used in databases, like primary key, foreign keys, exclusion constraints, unique constraints, explicit locks, and so on, right? So that's how basically your data integrity is met. Coming to the next feature, that is performance. Now, performance is something that's very important to all of us, right? Because all of us want a good performance for any action that we do in industry basis, right? Now, since PostgreSQL meets with good performance standard, that clearly implies that, you know, it has been used for more than 30 plus years of active development. Now, to enable performance in PostgreSQL, we have various features like, you know, indexing or maybe sophisticated query planner, multi-version concurrency control, table partitioning, just-in-time compilation of expressions, and so on. Now, moving on to the next feature, that is reliability. Now, PostgreSQL also proves itself in the factor of reliability. That is because, you know, it has various functionalities like write-ahead logging, replication, point-in-time recovery, active standbys, and table spaces. Finally, coming to extensibility. Now, obviously, any database that you wish to use, you would obviously want to extend it to maybe any application that you might be using in the industry or maybe in your company, or also on an individual basis. Well, PostgreSQL provides all those functionalities with the help of stored functions in procedural language, foreign data wrappers, and many extensions that you'll see further in the session. So guys, these were the main six features of PostgreSQL, that is data types, data integrity, performance, reliability, security, and extensibility. So now that you know what is PostgreSQL, let's next look into how you can install PostgreSQL. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to install PostgreSQL on Windows. So apart from that, if you want to install PostgreSQL on any other operating system, well, the steps are really simple and the steps are almost same. So let's get started by installing PostgreSQL. So what I'm going to do is, let me open my Google Chrome, and then let's say I just type in PostgreSQL download, right? So once I type in, you have to first to go to the official website of theirs, that is postgresql.org/download. So this is where basically you'll have to go to first start installing PostgreSQL. So what I'm going to do is basically I have to install on Windows, right? So over here, you have to start choosing your operating system. So if you wish you install on Linux, like let's say, you know, Ubuntu, then you would choose this option. But since I'm going to install on Windows, I'm going to simply choose this particular option. So if I click on Windows over here, you'll be next redirected to this particular page. Now, this is the page, basically, you have to install the installer, right? So basically, every operating system that you choose, the official website of PostgreSQL will redirect you to a particular page, which will have this particular installer. So over here you can see that I have the Windows installer, and then I have to install, and then you can see the platform support, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just click on this option, download the installer. Now once I click on download the installer, this is where basically you have to choose your configuration, right? So either it is Linux or Windows or Mac OS, that's completely your choice on what operating system that you wish to choose. Since I've been installing on Windows, I'll choose Windows 64-bit, right? So I'm going to choose this particular option of download. And please remember the fact that, you know, try to install the most latest version so that you can get the maximum features that you want. So I'm going to install the 11.4 version for Windows 64-bit, right? So I'm going to just click on download over here. And then you see that, you know, you'll be redirected to this particular page that, you know, thank you for downloading PostgreSQL. And also on the left hand side, you'll see that, you know, PostgreSQL is getting downloaded, right? So let's wait for it to download. All right. So as you can see on my screen, it has got downloaded. So I'll just double click it so that we can open. Now, once you double click on the setup, you'll see that, you know, this particular dialog box opens, which says, welcome to PostgreSQL Setup Wizard, right? So now you just have to click on next, and then you have to choose the installation directory. I'm going to let it be as it is. So by default, -c program files PostgreSQL and 11. So that will be basically my installation directory. And then I'll click on next. Once I click on next, you'll get an option basically on the various components that you wish to install. Well, I wish to install all of them. So basically I'm installing the server, the PG admin, the stack builder and the command line tools. So now over here, let me tell you that, you know, the PG admin is the official GUI for PostgreSQL. So we'll be working on the GUI for this particular session. So I'm going to just let it be as it is since all of them are checked in, and then I'll click on next. Once I click on next, I have to next choose the directory under which I'll basically store my data, right? So this is basically my data directory, that is C program files PostgreSQL 11 data. So I'm going to let it be as it is, and then I'll click on next. Once I click on next, I have to mention my password for the database super user. So just mention the password, any password that you wish to. And please remember the fact that, you know, you have to remember this password to configure your server, right? So do not forget this password, and please make sure that you remember this password. After that, just click on next again, and then you have to select the port number. So I'm going to let it be as it is. So basically my server will run on the port 5032, and then I'll click on next. Once I click on next, you'll see that, you know, I can choose the default local to be used by the new database cluster. So I'm going to let it be as it is, and then I'm going to click on next. Once I click on next, you'll see that, you know, basically the following setting will be used for installation. That is basically whatever you have selected till now will be shown over there. That is the installation directory, the server installation directory, the data directory, the database port, the database super user, and so on, right? And then I'll click on next over here again. And now you'll see a confirmation that, you know, the setup is now ready to begin installing PostgreSQL on your computer. If you're fine with it, you can just click on next, else you can just go back, make the changes, and then again come back to this particular dialog box, right? So I'm fine with it. So I'll just click on next over here, and then you'll see that, you know, PostgreSQL is getting installed on my system. So let's wait for it to install. All right, now once the installation is done, you get a confirmation wizard that, you know, the setup has finished installing PostgreSQL on your computer, right? So you can just click on finish. And then if you want to launch the stack builder at your exit, you can just check in this box. Well, I'll just uncheck this particular box, and then I'll click on finish. Once I click on finish, basically guys, your installation is done. Now, if you search for PostgreSQL on your system, you'll clearly see options of the various stuff that we have installed, right? So as you can see on my screen, we have PG admin, we have the SQL shell, we have the documentation, the PG admin documentation, the release notes, and so on, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to open the SQL shell and also the PG admin. So let me just open. All right. Now, once you open the PG admin, you basically are asked for the master password. So if you remember while installing, I asked you to enter a password, right? So that's basically the password that you have to mention over here. So I'll just mention my password. Right? Now, once the password is entered, you'll clearly see that, you know, we have a server, and then automatically the server gets connected to databases and the super user database that is Postgres, right? Under this particular database, what we're going to do is we're going to basically use the different commands, that is the different SQL command categories. And then we're going to create a schema, table, and then we're going to choose how we can play around with databases, right? So on the SQL shell, what you can do is you can again similarly connect to the server. So you just basically have to click on enter because you're connecting your server on the local host. So I'll just click on enter that the database, basically the super user database, is Postgres. So I'll click on enter again. The port has to be the same, that is 5432. I'll click on enter again. The username will be Postgres. So I'll just click on enter again. And password is basically what password you mention while installing, right? So you'll mention the same password, and then you'll see that, you know, once you hit on enter, you'll clearly see that you've been redirected to Postgres. So basically, that's how, guys, you can configure server either on the pgAdmin and also on the SQL shell. So guys, that was about installation of PostgreSQL on Windows. I hope you've understood all the steps. So now that you've installed PostgreSQL on your system, next let's look into the SQL command categories. So as I said, there are mainly four command categories. That is the data definition language commands, the data manipulation language commands, the data control language commands, and the transaction control language commands, right? So basically, guys, these are the main four command categories of SQL. That is the DDL commands, the DML commands, the DCL commands, and the TCL commands. The DDL commands basically consists of the commands which can be used to define your schema, right? So you can create a table, you can create a schema, you can create a view, and so on, right? So basically, all those commands which define the database of the schema, basically how your data has to be represented and what would be the various tables, or maybe let's say which table will be related to other table and so on, will be all under this particular section. That is the data definition language commands. Coming to data manipulation language commands, the DML commands basically consist of those commands which deal with the manipulation of data present in the database. So all the manipulation that you'll do in your databases will be with the help of the data manipulation language commands. Coming to the data control language commands, the data control language commands basically includes those commands which deal with the rights, permissions, and other controls of the database system. Like, you know, which database has to be granted to any specific user, or maybe that particular database will be open to public, and so on. And finally, coming to transaction control language commands. So the transaction control language commands basically include those commands which mainly deal with the transaction of the database. So guys, these are mainly the four different command categories. That is the DDL, DML, DCL, and TCL. So without wasting any further time, let's look into the DDL commands. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you how you can write commands on the SQL shell. And then I'm going to use the pgAdmin, right? So it's really simple. pgAdmin is the GUI for PostgreSQL. In today's market, in industries, people are mostly using pgAdmin because, you know, they can connect this particular database to various other external tools also, so that, you know, they can manipulate the data and maybe they can generate reports and so on, right? So I'm going to initially show you on SQL shell for few commands, and then I'll completely shift over to the GUI. So now let's say, you know, you want to create a schema. How do you think you can create a schema? Well, the command is really simple. For that, you'll have to use create, right? So what you'll do is basically you'll type in create schema, and let's say we mention the schema name to be information, right? Right. So I'm going to use caps so that you understand that, you know, that's the particular syntax, and the small case letters to understand that's the name that I'm giving, and that's completely your choice on how you wish to do. And then I'll end with a semicolon and click on enter. Once I click on enter, you'll see an output that, you know, create schema. That means, you know, a schema has been created. Now, if I go back to my pgAdmin and then let's say, you know, I just refresh over here. So automatically you'll see a schema that is information, right? So basically whatever I've created in SQL shell is automatically seen in pgAdmin, right? So that's the reason I told you it's easy to visualize and use GUI over here. Now, similarly, if you wish to create a new schema over here, what you can do is you have the schema option, right? You right click over here, choose create, and choose create schema. Automatically, you just have to mention the name. Let's say I mention sample, and then I'll leave the other details to be the same, that is security, default privileges, and SQL, right? So in SQL, you'll basically see that, you know, the syntax that I just mentioned in the SQL shell, that is create schema and then schema name and authorization Postgres. That's basically our database super user. Well, that's by default in SQL shell because, you know, we are already under Postgres. So that's the reason we didn't have to give it over there. So I'll just click on save. And then once I click on save, you'll automatically see that a schema has been created, that is basically sample. So now I have the information schema, the public schema, and the sample schema. Now the public schema is created by default, and the information was the one that I created in SQL shell, and the sample is the one I created in GUI. So you see, right, how simple it is. Now, if you're getting confused how you can write queries in GUI, well, don't worry, we have a query tool also. So if I right click over here, and then if I choose query tool, you'll see that, you know, automatically you'll get a workspace where you can basically put all your queries. I'm not going to do that. Now next what I'll do is, let's say, you know, we want to use this particular schema. So what I'll do is I'll just type in the query set search path to, and then I'll mention the schema name, right? So I'll mention information over here. So automatically you'll see an output that, you know, it is set to information, right? So whatever actions that I wish to perform, like, you know, creating tables or maybe views and all of them will be basically under this particular schema. Now, once the path is set, let's say, you know, we want to create a table, right? So for that, you'll type in create table and then you'll mention this table name. So let's say I mention students, and now each student will basically have various attributes, right? For example, let's say I'm a student. Now I'll have a name, I have an age, I have a date of birth and so on. So basically all those values will be a column. So I'll just put it in brackets and let's say I mention student ID and int to be data type. And let's say further, I again mention student name and then let the data type be varchar 255 characters, right? And then what I'll do is I'll put a semicolon at the end. Once I click over here, once I click on enter, you'll clearly see an output that, you know, create table. Now let's go back over here and then let's just basically refresh the schemas, right? So I'll just refresh the schemas. And under the information table, you'll clearly see an output that, you know, we have a table students and then it has columns student ID and student name. So basically that's how you can create a table basically on the SQL shell, guys. Now, if similarly, if you wish to create a table in the PG admin, what you do is you right click on the table over here, go to create, choose table, and then basically you have to mention the name, right? So for example, let's say we mention the table name to be teachers. And then the owner to be Postgres, the schema to be information. So you'll have to basically choose the schema under which you wish to create the table. And then you click on save. So if you click on save without choosing the columns, then remember that, you know, this particular table will have no columns. So if you wish to add columns, you can just add column over here. For example, let's say I wish to add column, right? So I'll go to plus button over here, choose the name. Let's say, you know, teacher ID. Let's say data type to be int. Right. And then, you know, not null primary key and all, I'll come later on this session. Right. So I'll click on save over here. So once I click on save, you'll see that, you know, automatically a teacher's table will be created with a single column, that is teacher ID. Right. So guys, that's how basically you can create tables in the SQL shell and PG admin. Now, before I move forward and show you the various other commands related to DDL, let me cover a concept known as entity relationship diagram. Now, this particular concept is important over here because, you know, you have to understand how to create tables and how you have to relate those tables to the other tables and basically what will be the column values for this particular table. So as you can see on my screen, guys, this is the example for entity relationship diagram that I'm going to consider for this particular session. Now, based on this particular diagram only, I'm going to basically take forward my session to show you the different commands also. Now, entity relationship diagram basically is a simple diagram through which you can understand the various relationships between two different tables or two or more tables, right? For example, let's say, you know, we have this particular entity relationship diagram, right? Now, over here, we have employee, department, project, and dependent over here. Now, all the rectangular boxes on this particular screen will represent entities. Now, what I mean by entities is basically that, you know, for example, let's say I'm a person, right? Now, I have a name. Now, my name, my age, my phone number, my date of birth, my address, all these are basically my attributes, right? And I, as a person, can be uniquely identified with the help of these particular attributes, right? So whatever can be uniquely identified with the help of attributes is basically entity, right? So I am an entity. So for example, I'm Sahithi, right? So my name, my age, my date of birth, all of this will be attributes through which anybody can identify me as Sahithi. Right. So over here, any employee can be uniquely identified with the help of an SSN, that is basically a social security number, or you can simply understand as ID. Name. Now, name further can have the first name, the last name, and the middle name. Now, address, salary, and sex. Right. So basically, all these attributes can uniquely identify an employee. Right. So employee over here is an entity, and all these particular attributes are basically the factors through which you can identify. So when you build a relational database management system, what happens is that employee will become the table name, and all these particular values, that is basically the attribute values, will be the column names. Right. So you'll have a column name with SSN, birth date, first name, middle name, last name, address, salary, and sex, right? So all this basically will be your column name, and then employee will be your table name. Now, similar is the case with the other factors also. For example, if you take department, now a department can be uniquely identified with number and name, right? So these two will be attributes, and the locations is basically a multi-valued attribute. Now, when I say multi-valued attribute, what I mean by that is an attribute can have various factors, right? For example, let's say location. What will be your address? You can have so much of street, let's say, you know, 5th Street, 4th Crossroad, and let's say Queens Road, right? So this could be basically your location, right? Now, this has various attributes, like, you know, maybe you can have 5th Street, like the streets can be put into one value, and maybe the Queens Road, basically the main locality, can be another value, right? So basically, it's a multi-valued attribute. That's what basically double ellipses mean. Apart from that, also, please remember that even this particular attribute will be included into the columns part. So you'll have a department table with the department number and department name as columns. Now, apart from that, next, let's look into project. Now, project is again another entity, right? So every project can be again uniquely be identified with the project number and the project name and the location, right? Now, over here, the project number and the project name will be unique for each and every project. So that is the reason for every entity, for this particular entity, these two attributes are very important over here, because every project can be uniquely identified with the project number and the project name. And finally, coming to dependent. Now, you must be wondering over here, why does the dependent entity have two rectangles, right? That is because, you know, it is a weak entity. What I mean by weak entity is basically that, you know, the dependent entity is basically dependent on the employee entity, right? For example, let's say, you know, I as an employee, right? So I am an employee, and then maybe I'm going for an insurance, right? And then I have a health insurance who, and my next nominee, let's say, is my sister. So what happens over here is basically that, you know, this particular entity is dependent on the employee entity. My details will be basically taken from the employee entity, right? So for example, let's say I am an employee, then all my details will be taken from the employee entity, right? So that is the reason basically the dependent entity is completely dependent on the employed entity. So that's what you have to understand over here. When I say weak entity, you have to understand that, you know, it is dependent on any other particular entity, right? Now over here, I hope you understood what is entities and what is attributes. Next, if you look into the diagram, we have various other factors, like, you know, these diamonds, and then we have double lines, we have single lines, and so on, right? So let's look into what they are. So coming to diamonds over here, when I say diamond, what I mean by that is basically the relationship set. So what is relationship set? So if you have to understand this, then you can understand that, you know, employees are related to every department, right? So if you take your company, any number of employees, like, you know, more than one instance of the entity is basically associated with one instance of the department, right? So in simple terms, if you just have to understand it, like, let's say, you know, 10 employees are working in one particular department, let's say IT department. So that's how basically you can understand this. Now coming to the next relationship, that is managers. Now there's a relationship between employees and department also, right? So there's a department, and then there's a manager for each and every department, right? So now not all employees are managers for the departments, right? So it could happen that, you know, only one instance of the employee entity is basically associated with one instance of the department entity, right? So let's say, you know, we have the IT department. Now the IT department can basically have only one manager, the HR department can have only one manager, and so on, right? So basically all of them are also employees, right? So that is the reason there's a relationship between employees and department over here. Now coming to the next relationship, that is works on. Now it is obvious to the fact that, you know, all the employees must be working on some or the other projects, right? For example, let's say, you know, we can have 10 employees working on two projects, or maybe, you know, the same number of employees working on some other projects also, right? It's never that in industry that a single employee is working only on single project and not more than one project, right? So in this particular relationship, that is the reason we have M is to N. Basically by that, what I mean that, you know, more than one instance of the entity employee is basically associated with more than one instance of the other entity, that is the project's entity, right? So that is because any number of employees can work on any number of projects. Similarly, let's look into the next relationship, that is dependence of. What I see in the relationship of dependence of is basically 1 is to n. That is because, you know, one employee can have any number of insurance, right? You can have a life insurance and so on. So that is the reason basically you have 1 is to n relationship, and then you have the relationship of dependence of, because your dependence entity is completely dependent on the employee entity. And finally, coming to self-referencing relationship over here, what I mean by self-referencing relationship is basically basically that, you know, for example, let's say you have a boss, right? Now your boss can handle 10 people, right? So basically he's your supervisor and then he supervises 10 people, right? And he himself is also an employee and all the 10 people are also employees, right? So that is where this particular relationship comes into picture. That is 1:N, right? So one instance of the employee where employee is basically a supervisor can supervise more than one instance of the other employees, right? So basically that's how it happens. You basically have different relationships like this, guys. If I have to just summarize the different relationships, then you have 1:1, 1:N, N:1, M:N, right? And then you also have self-referencing relationships. So if you have to talk in technical terms, then you have one-to-one relationship, one-to-many relationship, many-to-one relationship, and many-to-many relationship. Apart from that, we also have the self-referencing relationship that I just spoke about. Now, if you observe the complete entity relationship diagram over here, so I hope you've understood how entities, attributes, and relationship works in the databases, right? Now let's look into the double lines over here. What do you think the double lines mean? What I mean by total participation is basically that, you know, each entity in the entity set must at least have one relationship in the relationship set. So basically each entity in the employee must work in some or the other department, right? So that is the reason we basically have total participation over here. Moving on to the next relationship, you can see that, you know, it's not necessary that every employee manages some or the other person, right? So that is the reason we don't have total participation on this particular side, but yes, every department has a boss, right? So every department has a manager. So that's the reason we have total participation on this particular side, that is from managers to department. Moving on to the next relationship, that is basically employees to project. If you see, every employee has to work on some or the other project, right? So that is the reason we have total participation on both the sides, that, you know, every employee basically will be working on something or the other thing and every project will have a set of employees working on it, right? So that is the reason we have total participation over here. Coming to the next relationship, you can clearly see that, you know, that the dependents are basically completely dependent on employees. So it's the total participation towards from the dependent side and not from the employee side, because, you know, it can happen that, you know, maybe an employee doesn't have some insurance or maybe an employee doesn't have any insurance, right? So in that scenario, what basically happens is that you don't have total participation over here, but you have total participation on this particular side. And now finally coming to this particular relationship, if you observe over here, we do not have any total participation. That's because, you know, it's not necessary that every person in the employee table, basically every person in the company should be a supervisor of somebody, right? It's not necessary like that. Maybe a fresher is just not a supervisor. So in that scenario, basically total participation will not hold true. So that is basically, guys, how you can build up an entity relationship diagram for the scenario that you have. I took a company database where, you know, you have various entities like employees, department, dependent, projects, and then they are related to each other in some way or the other, and each of these entities have various attributes. So remember the fact that, you know, when you build a relational database, you have entities which will basically become your tables, then you have attributes, so your attributes will basically become your column names, and then you have relationships. So guys, this was all about entity relationship diagrams. You basically have entities, attributes, and then relationships, right? So I hope you've understood how my ER diagram looks like. Now, as I was talking about different kinds of attributes, let me next take you through what are the different kinds of attributes that you see. So you must have observed, right? We had multi-valued attributes, we had derived attributes, and then we have complex attributes and composite attributes. So basically there are various attributes like, you know, composites, simple, single, multi-valued, stored, derived, and complex attributes. So let's look into each one of them one by one. So talking about composite and simple attributes, guys, if you remember the entity relationship diagram I showed you, I told you that the name can have first name, last name, and middle name. The first name, last name, middle name will basically be my simple attributes, and the name altogether will be my complex attribute. So basically, if I have to define in single terms, then a composite attributes can be divided into smaller subparts, and these subparts can represent individual basic attributes with their own meaning. For example, let's say we have address, right? Now address can have street address, city, state, zip, and street address can be further divided into number, street, and house number. Now city, state, zip, number, street, and house number will basically be your simple attributes. So this was about composite and simple, guys. Now let's move forward with the next type of attributes, that is single and multi-valued. Now, attributes having a single value for a particular entity are known as single-valued attributes, and a multi-valued attribute may have lower and upper bounds to constrain the number of values allowed for each individual entity. So you can have a single attribute and a multi-attribute in an entity. And I forgot to tell you one thing over here. Every entity is uniquely identified, right? So as I told you, employee had SSN, that is the social security number. Now that is basically uniquely identified, right? So that is the SSN. So over here, that will be basically a unique attribute through which the complete table will be identified. Next, let's move forward with the next type of attribute, that is stored versus derived. So the attributes which are derived from the real entities are known as derived attributes, and the stored attributes are the attributes which are already stored in the database and from which the value of another attribute is derived. So basically, if you consider age, from age you can derive birth date, right? And from birthday you can derive age, right? So I'm not saying in the matter of exact birthday, you can, like, let's say you're 23 years. So you can derive the fact, you know, the birthday could be either in 95, 96. And if, you know, the year born is 95, 96, then automatically you can derive an age that, you know, the age could be 23 years, right? So that's how basically you can understand stored and derived attribute. And finally, coming to complex attributes, the attributes that can be represented by grouping composite attributes between, you know, brackets, by separating the components with commas, and by displaying multivalued attributes with square brackets are known as complex attributes, right? So basically, an address can have phone number, and then the phone can have again like area code and phone numbers. And then moving forward, we can have again address, and maybe address can again have street address, number street, flat number, state, zip code, and so on. So basically, this is how you can define complex attributes, guys. So guys, that was about entity relationship diagrams. So I hope you've understood how entities work, how attributes work, how a table name can be found, and how columns are formed, and how each table can be related to the other table, because this concept is really important to understand so that you understand the further concepts like, you know, the keys in databases and the constraints used. Now, before I wrap up this entity relationship diagram, let me just shift back to my PG admin and show you the simple commands of DDL, like, you know, the create, truncate, alter, and so on. So for example, let's say, you know, you want to truncate the table, right? So when I say truncate, what I mean by that is you basically delete all the data present in the table, but you do not delete the table itself. Now, since we haven't added any data into the table, I'll just show you the syntax so that you can understand. So let's say, you know, you want to truncate table students, right? So for that, what you'll do is you'll type in truncate table, and then you'll mention students, right? And then you'll execute, right? Once you execute, you'll see the output that, you know, truncate table, the query has been returned successfully. Now, since we have no data is present, you cannot see any particular output. But if you had any data present in the table, you would see that, you know, all the data would be removed from the table. Now, let's say, you know, you want to rename the table. Let's say you want to rename the table students to, let's say, info students, right? So to rename the students, you basically have to use two DDL statements, that is alter table and rename, right? So for that, what you'll do is you'll type in alter table, and then you'll mention the original name, that is students, and then you wish to rename, right? So you'll type in rename to, and then you'll mention the new name, that is info students, right? And then you'll execute. Once you execute, you'll see that, you know, alter table, the query has been returned successfully. So what I'll do is I'll just refresh this particular schema, and then you'll automatically see that, you know, we see an output of info students, right? So that means our table has been renamed. Now, for example, let's say, you know, we want to add a new column. So for that, again, you'll use the alter statement. So I'll just type in alter table, and then I'll mention the table name, that is info students. And then what you'll do is you'll mention add, and then you'll mention the column name, that is, let's say, you know, date of birth, and then the data type of it, let's say date, right? And then you'll end with semicolon, and then you'll execute. Once you execute, you'll see that, you know, the query has been returned successfully. So if I just refresh this part again, and you'll see automatically that, you know, a new column has been added onto the table, that is date of birth. So this was just for a single column, guys. Now you can add multiple columns also. So for example, let's say I want to add two more columns, right? So what I'll do is I'll just remove this. Let's say, you know, I want to add gender. So I'll just mention sex character, and again, comma, and add, let's say, class. Okay, class is a keyword, so I'll mention standard, and then integer, right? And then I'll again execute. Once I execute, I'll again refresh. And when I refresh, you'll see that, you know, automatically my sex and standard, so basically the gender, date of birth, and standard have been added as new columns, right? So that's how basically you can add a single column, or you can add multiple columns. Now you can also alter the data type of the particular column. For example, I want the data type of the standard column to be changed to, let's say, character. So for that, what you'll do is you'll basically mention alter table info students, that is basically the table name. And then what you'll do is you'll mention alter column, and then you'll mention the column name that is basically standard, and then you'll mention the keyword type, and let's say we mention character, and then I'll execute. And now once I execute, and then if I show you the properties of this particular column, you'll automatically see that, you know, the data type is character, right? So basically, guys, that's how you can also alter a particular table or maybe column, maybe if you want to rename and all. Now let's say, you know, you want to drop this particular column. So for that, what you do is you type in alter table, mention the table name again. And then what you do is you mention the keyword drop column, and then you mention the column name, right? And then you just execute. Now once you execute, and let's say if I refresh this, you'll clearly see an output that, you know, your standard column is gone, right? So that's how basically you can drop a column. Now similarly, if you want to rename a column, it's really simple. You have to write a query like, you know, alter table, the table name, and then you have to mention rename column, and then you mention the column name to the new column name, right? For example, let's say I want to change the column name of sex. So what I'll mention is alter table info students, rename column sex to gender. So that's how you can basically rename a column also. Now simply, let's say, you know, if you want to drop a table. Now if you want to drop a table, I'll mention drop table, and then I'll mention the table name, right? So I'll just click on execute, and then you'll see that, you know, automatically your table will be dropped. So if I just refresh this, you'll see that, you know, we just have one particular table, that is teachers, and the students table is gone. So guys, this is how basically you can work on PG admin for basically the DDL commands, right? What I'm going to do is for this particular session, I'm going to consider the ER diagram as I mentioned before, right? So I'm going to create tables and manipulate data over those particular tables only. So before I move forward with this session, what I'll do is I'll explain you the different keys and constraints used in the database so that it's more clear to you how you can create the database in a more structured manner, and then we'll move forward with the various manipulation commands. Until then, what I'll do is I'll just delete this particular table. So I'll right click here, go to delete, and click on OK. And then let's say, you know, we'll delete this particular schema also so that there's no confusion at all. And then what I'll do is I'll close this shell also. So guys, remember that, you know, I am using PG admin. Well, you can use the same queries that I mentioned there on SQL shell also, and you'll see the same output. So I hope that's clear. So I'm going to close the SQL shell, and then I'll continue with this session. So now moving forward with this session, let's start with the next topic, that is keys in database. So there are mainly five types of keys in database, that is the candidate key, the super key, the primary key, the alternate key, and the foreign key. So talking about the candidate key is basically the minimal set of attributes which can uniquely identify a tuple. So any minimal set of attributes which can uniquely identify a tuple is known as a candidate key. So the value of the candidate key will be unique and non-null for every tuple. So if you have to identify a specific tuple, let's say Sahithi, age 24, let's say date of birth 30 October, and so on, then you need a particular candidate key to uniquely identify my tuple, right? So that particular can be my employee ID and so on. Now let me tell you one thing over here, there can be more than one candidate key in a relation also. So a candidate key can also be either simple key or a composite key. Now coming to super key. Now super key is basically again the set of attributes which can uniquely identify a tuple. So any set of attributes which can uniquely identify a tuple is known as a super key, but it's not the minimal set of attributes. The minimal set of attributes is the candidate key, but as any set of attributes which can uniquely identify is known as a super key. So when you add zero or more attributes to a candidate key, it becomes a super key, but the vice versa is not true. So a candidate key is definitely a super key, guys, but the super key is not a candidate key. So that's what you have to understand. Now moving on to primary key. Now primary key is also a set of attributes which can be used to uniquely identify every tuple. Now if you remember the entity relationship diagram that I was explaining you, I said the employee table has a special social security number through which every tuple will be identified, right? So that particular social security number will be the primary key through which every tuple will be identified. And now apart from that, there can be more than one candidate key in a relation, right? So out of all the candidate keys present in the relation, you can choose any one key as the primary key. So if you have around five candidate keys, out of them, one can be definitely your primary key for that particular relation. Moving on to the next type of key, that is the alternate key. So the candidate keys other than primary keys are basically the alternate keys. So as I was giving you an example of five candidate keys, so if there are five candidate keys in a relation, then out of which, if let's say, you know, the first key is chosen as the primary key, then the other four keys will be the alternate keys. And finally, moving on to the foreign key. So the foreign key is basically the key if an attribute can only take the values which are present as values of some other attribute. So basically, whenever an attribute can only take the values which are present as values of some other attribute, then it will be basically be the foreign key to the attribute to which it refers. So basically, the relation which is referenced is called reference relation, and the relation which refers to the reference relation is called the referencing relation. So the referenced attribute of the referencing attribute should be a primary key, right? For example, let's say, you know, you have employee and department, right? Now you want to reference department to employee. So what will happen is you'll basically use a foreign key to validate this relationship, and then you'll add a foreign key from department to employee. I hope that's clear. So guys, these were the various keys that you need to understand about. That is the candidate key, super key, primary key, alternate key, and the foreign key. So now that you know the different keys in database and you know the DDL commands also, let me take you to the constraints in database so that we can quickly create the tables that we discussed in entity relationship diagram, right? So the constraints in the database are, as you can see on my screen, that is not null, unique, check, default, and index. So the not null constraint basically ensures that, you know, a null value cannot be stored in a column. For example, let's say, you know, you have a students table. Now in the students table, you have a column known as student ID. And then when you're creating the table, you mention the not null constraint for this particular column. Then whenever you're inserting the data, you have to remember that, you know, there cannot be a null value in this particular column, that is the student ID. Coming to unique constraint makes sure that, you know, all the values in the column are different. So in whichever columns that you want to store unique values, you have to use this constraint unique. Coming to check, this constraint ensures that all the values in a column satisfy a specific condition. So you have to check, let's say, you know, we want to store the age of employees. Now let's say age has to be greater than 25. So only the age values whose value will be greater than 25 will be stored in the age column if you mention this particular constraint. Now moving on to the next constraint, that is the default constraint. This particular constraint consists of a set of default values for a column when no value is specified. So whenever, let's say, you know, you have not inserted any value specifically, then automatically a default value will be stored in that particular cell if you use this particular constraint. And finally, coming to the index constraint, this constraint is used to create and retrieve data for database very quickly. So if you want to create and retrieve data from database very quickly, then you have to use this particular constraint, that is index. So guys, I hope the keys and constraints concept is clear to you guys. So now that, you know, we have understood the entity relationship diagram, the constraint and the keys, let me shift back to my PG admin. And now let's say, you know, I'll start creating table. So I'll just show you for one table, and then I've already a set of commands that I've already executed. You know, I'm just going to copy paste the command over here. So what I'm going to do is, we had the employee table, right? So for that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to mention create schema first so that you create a schema. So I'm just going to mention create schema. Let's say we mention schema name to be company. After that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to use this particular schema, right? So I'll just mention set search path to company. Now, automatically, if I just refresh over here, you'll see that, you know, there are two schemas, that is company and public. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create tables inside this particular schema. So for that, what I'll do is I'll mention create table. Let's say we mention employee. And in brackets, what I'll do is I'll mention all the column names. So we had first name. Let's say we mentioned text, not null. So I'm using a constraint known as not null, right? So this particular constraint is used. That means that, you know, there cannot be a null value in this particular column. Similarly, let's do for middle name. Let's say char null, right? So there can be null values over here. Now last name, let's say text not null, right? Now I have basically a social security number, right? So I'll put SSN, let's say character of, let's say 9 characters. Let's be specific over here. And I'll put not null, so this cannot be null. And I also want it to be the primary key. So basically through this particular number, the complete table will be uniquely identified. After that, I'll mention birth date, and then I'll mention the data type to be date, right? Let's mention address. And let's say I mentioned data type to be text, not null. This also cannot be null, right? Similarly, I'll mention sex, let's say character null. Now, similarly, I'll mention salary, let's say decimal and then 10 to 2. And this can be null, so we don't know. It can happen that, you know, we don't know the salaries, right? Then I'll mention super SSN. So this is basically to identify the self-referencing relationship, if you remember, right? And then I'll mention character of 9 characters, and this can be null. And then let's say we mentioned department number, let it be int, and let's say not null because we don't want it to be null, right? Now what I'll do is I'll just execute this particular query. Now once I execute this particular query, you'll see that, you know, automatically we get an output that create table. So our table is successfully created. So if I refresh this particular schema and then if I open tables, you'll clearly see that, you know, we have the employee tables. Now similarly, what I'm going to do is for all these particular entities, I'm going to create table, right? So I already have a doc present, so I'm just going to copy paste from that. So let me just open that doc, right? So let me just copy paste from here. So I'm going to copy for department, department locations, projects, works on, and dependent. Now I'll go back to my PG admin. And then what I'll do is I'll just paste it over here. So what I'm doing is, let me just explain you. So I'm creating a table department with the column names as department name, department number, MGR SSN. That's because for the relationship of manager, right? So if you remember, if I just open a diagram, you'll clearly see that, you know, employee manager's department, right? So you see for this particular relation, and then MGR start date. That is because, you know, we have to consider the column present on the relationship also, that is managers. Similarly, I'm creating department locations, that is with department number, department location, and primary key as department number and location together. Then I'm creating a table known as project. So the project table will have project name, project number, location, and then I've used the primary key to be project number, and then the project name has to be unique, right? So I've used a constraint over there. Similarly, I'm creating a table known as works on. So for the works on table, I have employee SSN, the project number, the hours worked, and the primary key to be the employee number and the project number together. The dependent table will again have the employee number, the dependent name, sex, birthday, relationship, and the primary key to be employee SSN and dependent name, right? So I'll just execute all these particular queries. So you can see that, you know, automatically my query has got successfully executed. So I'll just refresh this particular table again. So once I refresh this particular schema, you'll see that, you know, I have 6 tables, that is the department, dependent, dependent locations, employee, project, works on, right? So guys, that's how basically you can create tables, and that's how you can use keys and constraints while creating tables. So guys, that was all about the data definition language commands. I hope you understood how you can use them and create databases. Now, before I move on to the next topic, that is the data manipulation commands, let me take you through an interesting topic, that is normalization. So what is normalization? So normalization is a technique that organizes tables in such a way that, you know, the redundancy and the dependency of data is reduced. So obviously, when you're storing humongous amount of data on an industry level, there could be scenarios where you have redundancy. So normalization is basically that technique through which, you know, you can remove the redundancy and dependency of the data. So as you can see on my screen, the normalization is basically at 4 levels, that is 1NF, 2NF, 3NF, and BCNF. So let's discuss the same now. Now, before I move forward with 1NF, let me tell you that, you know, I'm going to consider this particular example. So the example that you can see on my screen is basically of 3 people, you know, living in specific address, and they've rented few movies of a specific category. Now, you definitely see redundancy in this particular table, right? That's because, you know, you see Alice Johnson has rented 2 movies, that is Mission Impossible and Clash of Titans. Similarly, David Allen's address has been divided, and also the movies rented have also been divided into different categories, right? Like the sci-fi movies are put into one category and the action movies put into the next category, and both of them are in 2 different tuples. This is definitely a redundant data, right? Now, how do you think you can normalize the data? Well, we'll start with 1NF. Now, the rule of 1NF is really simple, guys. What the rule says is that, you know, each table cell should have a single value. So basically, any table that you have, and then you wish to normalize the data from that particular table, you have to make sure that, you know, each table cell has a single value. So for example, we had Alice Johnson and David Allen, right? So if you remember from the previous slide, we had movies rented together, right? So for Alice Johnson, we had Mission Impossible and Clash of Titans in the same tuple. And for David Allen, we had the address divided, but also the movies also divided. So what I've done over here is, to get the data into 1NF, what I've done is I've divided all the movies rented into different tuples. So Alice Johnson staying in First Street, house number 3, has basically, you know, specific movies rented, that is Mission Impossible and Clash of Titans. So what I've done is I've divided both these movies into two different tuples. The same goes for David Allen. If you remember from the previous slide, what happened is that, you know, in the 3rd Street 45 address 1, David Allen had Interstellar and Edge of Tomorrow together, right? So what I've done is I've divided those two into two different tuples again, and David Allen's 7th Avenue into the next tuple. So this is basically how I've got my table into 1NF. Each table cell basically has only one single value. If you observe over here, there's still a problem, right? That's because, you know, our address is redundant for Alice Johnson, and for David Allen, our address is redundant, and yes, it is divided also. It's not all together. So for that, what we'll do is we'll convert this table into 2NF. So basically, to normalize the database into 2NF, remember the fact that, you know, the database should be in 1NF and should also have a single column primary key. What I mean by that is, you know, what I'm going to do is I'm going to divide the table into two different tables such that, you know, for each specific user, I'm going to identify the specific movie rented. For example, let's say, you know, I give Alice Johnson staying in First Street, house number 3, ID number 1. Now, I know she rented Mission Impossible and Clash of Titans, right? So what I did was I gave the movies Mission Impossible and Clash of Titans, which are rented by Alice Johnson, the ID 1. Similarly, what I did is for David Allen staying in 3rd Street 45, basically for that particular tuple, I've given the ID to be 2. We know that, you know, he must have rented Interstellar and Edge of Tomorrow, right? So for those particular movies, I've given the ID to be 2. And finally, for Mission Impossible Fallout, that is basically rented by David Allen staying in 7th Avenue, what I've given is I've given ID number 3. So that's how basically I've divided 1NF table into 2NF. Now, if you see over here, there's still a problem, right? Now, that's because, you know, we still have redundant data with respect to Alice Johnson and David Allen, right? Because David Allen's name comes twice. Alice Johnson, who rents two movies, comes once. But yes, the address is also divided for David Allen. So to normalize this factor, what we'll do is we'll normalize again. So now we'll normalize the database, which is in the form of 2NF to 3NF. Now, if you want to normalize the database from 2NF to 3NF, the database should be in 2NF and must not have any transitive functional dependencies. So for that, what I'll do is I'll basically add a salutation ID. So basically, I'm going to identify Mr. from 1, Miss from 2, Mrs. from 3, and Dr. from 4. So in that way, what will happen is that, you know, David Allen's name won't come twice because he'll be uniquely identified with Mr. So we'll type in Mr. David Allen, so that will only comes once, and then all the movies will come together. So that's how, guys, basically you can normalize your database. So we've normalized from 1NF to 2NF, 2NF to 3NF, and finally comes BCNF. Now, since my example ends there, so I'm not going to normalize it further. But yes, if your database is not yet normalized, you can then go forward and normalize again, that is BCNF. So to perform the normalization for the fourth time, what you can do is you have to normalize, right? So the condition to normalize it again is basically that, you know, your database must be in 3NF. And maybe, you know, even after being in 3NF, there would be some anomalies and it may have more than one candidate. Now, in such scenarios, what will happen is BCNF will come into the picture and then it will divide the tables further so that there would be only one candidate key present. So whenever after 3NF, you observe that, you know, there's more than one candidate key and then you'll have to normalize it again, that's where BCNF comes into picture to divide the table further. So guys, this was about normalization. I hope you've understood how you can normalize your databases. Now let's move forward with the next topic for today's session, that is data manipulation commands. Now the data manipulation commands, as I said before, are basically the commands which are basically used to manipulate your databases. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to manipulate data present in the database that I've created over here, that is in the 6 tables that I've entered. So to initially manipulate data, you need data present in your table. So now to do that, what you have to do is you have to insert data. So to insert data, what you'll type in is insert into. And then let me show you for employee table, employee, and then you'll mention values, and then you'll have to mention the values that you wish to enter, right? So let's say I'll wish to enter John as first name, and let's say I'll enter middle name, let it be a character. Now, similarly, I'll enter the next name, let's say Smith, that is basically my last name. Sorry, the comma has to go at the end. Now, I'll enter SSN, right? After that, what I'll do is I'll enter birth date. So let's say, you know, I mentioned 1965-0109. Then let's say, you know, I mention address. So let's say I mention 731 Houston TX. And let's say further, I mention the gender to be male. And then let's say we mention salary to be 30,000. And then we mentioned super SSN, let's say triple tree, double four, four times five. And let's say we mentioned the department number to be five. Now, once this is done, you can just execute this particular query. So what you can do is you can just hit on execute and you'll see that, automatically the query has been returned successfully. That means the data is filled. So if you want to see the data output, what you can do is you can use the other manipulation command that is basically select star from employee. So that will basically show you all the values present in the employee table. So let me just mention that. And then I'll hit on execute and you'll see that, automatically you see the data present in the table. That is whatever we have mentioned over here. Now, since guys, filling data would be a waste of time for me to explain for each and every value, I've already put it in my doc. So I'll just copy paste from there so that we can move faster in the session, right? So let me just copy paste these commands. So if you observe over here, what I'm doing is I'm entering data into the department table, the dependent table, the department locations table, projects table, works on table, and so on. So I'm not entering just one, I'm entering quite an amount of details. So what I'll do is I'll just select all of them together and then I'll hit on execute. Once I hit on execute, you'll see that, the query has been returned successfully. That means that, automatically our data has been entered into our tables, right? So if you just want to check how if the data has been entered or not, you can similarly use the same command that I just showed you, that is select star from and then you mention the table name. So now let's move forward with the session. Now, as you remember from the entity relationship diagram, I said there were relations between two entities, right? So those relations are basically mapped into picture with the help of foreign keys that I mentioned before, right? So to add foreign keys, what you'll do is you'll have to alter the table since the tables are already created. So what you can do is either you alter the table or the other way completely around is basically whenever you're creating the table, you can add foreign keys. So I'm just going to alter the table since my tables are already created. So for that, what I'll do is I'll put an alter table and let's say, I add a foreign key for the manager's relationship. So what will happen is I want to add a foreign key for the manager's relationship where, I'll say the department is managed by an employee, right? So what will happen is department will be our first table where we'll add a foreign key, basically MGR SSN, which references to employee table because every employee manages a department. So that's what I'm going to do. So I'll mention alter table and then let's say we mention department. Then I'll mention add foreign key. And then I'll mention the column attribute which has to match, right? So that is MGR SSN that I had created in the department table. And then I'll mention references. Oh, I'm sorry, there's a spelling mistake over here, right? And then I'll mention the table number two, that is employee to SSN. So basically, you have to add a foreign key to each of the columns, right? So you are basically trying to connect the MGR SSN column of a department table to SSN column of the employee table. You'll just execute this. And then once you execute this, you'll see that, query returned successfully. That means there is a foreign key, right? So for example, let's say if I just refresh this and then we go to the employee table and then if we see the properties and let's say, we go to constraints over here and in the primary key, we see that, it's SSN and in the foreign key, so there's nothing over here. So I had to go to the department table. So let's go to properties because, we are adding the foreign key from there, right? So I go to foreign key, you see that, MGR SSN foreign key, basically MGR SSN is connected to SSN. So you clearly see that, that's how you can add foreign key. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to add foreign keys for other tables also so that, we can move forward again. Let me just directly add it from here, right? So as you can see on my screen, I've mentioned a foreign key between employee SSN and an employee super SSN. So that was basically for our self-referencing relationship. Then I've mentioned a foreign key between department number and the department, basically who works on which department, right? So for that particular relationship. After that, I've mentioned a foreign key for department locations and the department. So basically which department is present in which location. After that, I've mentioned a foreign key between project and department, basically which department is looking into which project. And then I've mentioned a foreign key between works on table and employee table to understand which employee is working on which project or which department. And finally, on the dependent and the employee table to make sure the dependency relationship is taken into account. Right? So what I'll do is I'll just execute all these particular foreign keys. So I'll hit on execute. You'll see that, automatically the query has been executed, right? So guys, that's how basically you can add foreign keys to all your tables. you know, if you just refresh over here, and then if you check all the tables, you'll see that, you know, there is some or the other foreign key present for each and every table, that is for each and every relation. Now let's move forward. Now, for example, let's say, you know, I want to see all the details from the works on table, right? Now let's say, you know, I want to delete records with the project number, let's say 30. Let's try deleting, right? So if I try deleting, let me just try it over here. Delete from, you have to delete from the project table. And then I'm saying the project number, I've considered 30, right? So I'll just type in 30. And let's see what happens when we execute this. Okay, I'm sorry. Yes. Now, when you execute this particular statement, what do you see? You see an error that, you know, update or delete on the table project violates foreign key constraint, because we have a foreign key with respect to works on, right? So because we just mentioned over here that, you know, we'll have a foreign key with works on and project number. So now that's the reason we get this error. Now, to resolve this error, basically, I'm talking about the concept where you want to delete the records where foreign keys are present, right? So what you'll do is you'll initially delete the record from the works on table, and then you'll go forward and delete the records from the project table. So you directly won't come over here. What you'll do is you'll initially delete from works on table. So let's say P number is 30, right? So I'll delete the record from the works on table over here. You'll automatically see that, you know, query returned successfully. And now if we try deleting data from project table, what you'll clearly see that, you know, query is returned successfully. That means there was no violating error, right? So what happens is whenever you have a foreign key from A table to B table, remember that, you know, if you want to delete anything from the B table, you have to first delete it from the A table, and then you can go forward and delete it from the B table. Right. So guys, that was about the insert statement, the alter statement, and about foreign keys. Now in this session, what I'm going to do is I'm not going to talk about any theory part, like what's going to happen and then how you can use. What I'm going to do is I'm going to directly jump on the query so that you can understand how you can write queries and how you can manipulate data. So let's get started. So now let's say, you know, we want to update the salary of employees. So for example, let's say I'll just see which employee salary has to be updated. So I'll just type on select star from employee so that I can see the details. I'll just execute this. So when I execute this, you'll see that, you know, I have all the details, right? Now let's say, you know, I want to update the salary of a person, let's say employee, whose SSN is, let's say, 999884x7. Now let's say the salary is around 25,000, right? Now I want to update it to 27,000. What can I do is basically I have to use the update statement. So to use the update statement, what I can simply do is, let me just press on enter so that the screen is clear for you guys. I can just type in update, and then you have to mention the table name. So that will be employee. And then you'll mention set column name. And then what you'll do is you'll mention the new value that you want. That is, let's say 27,000. And then let's say where SSN, that is basically through which you can uniquely identify every tuple, right? So where SSN is equal to, what was the SSN? It was 999884x7, right? So I'll just type in 999884x7. And then what I'll do is I'll just end with a semicolon. Once I execute this, you see an output that, you know, query returned successfully, right? So now let me just go back over here and choose select star from employee. And now if we go back to this particular table, you can clearly see that, you know, the employee who had an SSN about 999884x7 has now a salary of 27,000. So guys, that's how you can update the values. So guys, that was about the update statement. Now let's say you want to delete a tuple's data, you know, let's say more than one condition. So what you can do is you can just use the delete statement. Okay, delete from, and then let's say we want to delete it from works on table, right? So I'll just type in works on, and then let's say where employee SSN, because our works on table has employee SSN as column, right? So over here, if you can see, we have ESSN. And let's say, you know, we use the same employee SSN, let's say 999884x7. And we also have project number details, right? So where I'll choose project number, let's say, right? So that is basically the data I had mentioned. So I'll just execute this particular query, and you'll see that, you know, automatically it's executed, right? So now if I just change this from employee to works on, and then if I execute this particular query, you can clearly see that, you know, we have no employee with employee ID of 999884x7 and working on project number 10's data present in the works on table. So guys, that was about how you can delete, update, insert and alter. Now let's move forward with one of the most important queries, that is the select query. Now the select query is basically considered as one of the most important queries because, you know, this is the query through which you can retrieve the data. So as you can see over here, I was using select query again and again because, you know, I wanted to retrieve the data that I have in my database. So that's where basically the select query comes into picture. Now, when I had select star from works on, that means all the data was shown. For example, let's say I just want the first name, last name and the address from the employee table. And let's say, you know, we are specific to department number 5. So what I can do is I can just type in select first name, last name, address, and I'll mention from employee. And let's say we mention department number is equal to 5. So I'll execute this particular query. So when I execute this particular query, you can see that, you know, John, Franklin, Ramesh and Joyce. So basically the first name, last name and address have come into picture, right? So that's how, guys, you can use a select query. Now, this was quite a simple one, right? Now, let's look into something more complicated. For example, let's say, you know, you want to retrieve data for every project located in Bellary, and then you want the project number, the controlling department number and the department manager's last name, address and birthday. So over here, if you observe, what all have I taken into account? The project number, the department manager's the last name, address and birthday. So if you observe over here, basically what's happening is there are three tables coming into picture, right? That's basically the project table, the department table and the employee table. So let's look into how we can write the query for this. So what all did I mention? I mentioned the project number, the department number, last name, address and birth date. So what I'll do is I'll mention select and then I'll mention all these factors, that is project number, DNUM, right? And then I'll mention LNAME, that is basically my last name. And then I'll mention address. Say we mentioned birth date, right? And then I mentioned from, what are the tables that I had considered? That is the project, department and the employee, right? So I'll mention project, department, employee, where DNUM is equal to D number. So basically the department number from the project table has to match the department number from the department table. Also, so that's basically you use an operator known as and then you mention MGR SSN, that is basically who manages the project, has to match with the employee code, that is right, SSN. Apart from that, we also have to mention that, you know, our project location is Bellary. So we'll mention and P location is equal to, in quotes, we'll mention Bellary, right? So if I just execute this particular query, you'll see an output that, you know, there are no tuples which satisfy this particular condition, right? So what I'm going to do is, let's say we change Bellary to, let's say, Houston, right? Now let's execute again. Now, if I execute on Houston, you can see that, you know, we've got the project number, the DNUM, the last name, the address and the birth date of basically all those employees who work on the project basically located in Houston. So that's how, guys, you can basically integrate 2 to 3 tables together and use the select statement to further play around with it. Now, if you remember, I was talking about the self-referencing relationship where, you know, we have employee related to himself, right? That was basically how a supervisor can have a supervisor. So for example, let's say, you know, for each employee, we want to retrieve the first name and the last name and also the first name and the last name of the supervisor. Then what we can do is we can use the select statement again, right? And then I'll mention e.fname and e.lname. So this is basically to identify every employee, right? So that is basically the supervisee. Now, if you want to identify the supervisor, what I'm going to do is I'll mention s.fname and s.lname. And then I'll mention from, and then I'll mention employee. Sorry, let me put it in small so that it's clear to you. From employee as E, right? So for every employee, that is basically for every supervisee, I'm identifying employee as E. And similarly for supervisor, I'm going to identify as S, right? So I'll mention employee as S, where E dot super SSN is equal to S dot SSN. Now, if I just execute this particular query, you see an output that, you know, we have the first name and the last names of the supervisees and the supervisors. So that's how basically you can play around with the names of the columns and the tables also, guys. So I hope you've understood this particular query. Now, moving forward, you might have heard about the term distinct. So when I say distinct, what I mean is I want to find out all the unique values, right? So to find out unique values, you have to use the term distinct. Let's say we want to find out the distinct salary values for all the employees, right? So now what I can do is I can just mention select distinct, and then I choose the column salary from the employee table, and then I click on execute. So you'll automatically see that, you know, we see all the distinct salary values present. So whenever you want to find out any unique values or let's say distinct values, this is basically the keyword that you have to use, that is distinct. So guys, that was about the distinct query. Now let's move forward and understand the cross product. Now cross product is something like, you know, when you have A into B, right? So basically you have A and then you want to find out all the combinations of A with B. That's when you use cross product. For example, let's say, you know, you want to find out all the SSNs, basically of all the SSNs of the employee, and then you want to find out all the combinations of employee SSNs with the department name. So let's do that. So what we can simply do is to perform cross product, you can mention select SSN and the name from, we'll mention employee and department. So if I just execute this particular query, you'll see that, you know, we get all the combinations of SSNs with department name. So let me just drag a little bit, right? So as you can see, we have for each SSN, we have various departments. Like you can see, we have the research department, the admin department, the headquarters department, and so on. So that's how basically you can perform cross product. Now, let's say, you know, if you want to take this query further. So let's say, you know, we want to find out all the employees who work in the department, let's say administration. So what we can simply do is we'll type in select star and then I'll mention from employee department. And then I'll mention a where condition which says the name is equal to administration and the number is equal to the number from the department table. So if you have any queries with how am I mentioning the column names, you can always refer to the tables that you have and then you can go back to the tables and check for the column names. For example, let's say I go to the department, then you can see that, you know, I have the department number over here. So I'll just execute this particular query now. And once I execute this particular query, you see that, you know, we get all the details of all the employees who work in the department administration, right? So if I just extend this, you'll clearly see the output, right? So guys, that's how basically you can play around with the select statements. Now before I move forward with the further data manipulation language commands, let's look into the next topic, that is operators. Now there are various kinds of operators present in the SQL commands, that is arithmetic operators, the bitwise operators, the comparison operators, and the compound operators. So the arithmetic operators are basically used to perform the arithmetic operations. As you can see on my screen, it's plus, minus, into, divide, and mod. Bitwise has bitwise AND, OR, and XOR. Comparison has greater than, less than, greater than, equal to, less than, equal to, and then not equal to, and so on. And the compound operators have, you know, increment, like, you know, A is equal to A plus 1 can be written as A plus equal to. So that's how basically you can use operators, guys. Well, I'm not going to explore more about operators because that's a really simple topic that you can explore about, right? So I've just given you a basic understanding of the top operators. Well, don't worry, we'll be looking forward into these particular operators later on in the session. So let's get started with our next topic for today's session, that is nested queries. So nested queries are SQL queries which have an outer query and an inner query. So the subquery is a query nested within another query such as select, insert, update, or delete. So for example, if you see the screen, that is basically the outer query and the inner query. So I have an outer query which says select last name, first name from employees. Let's say, you know, where address in, and then we choose, you know, we mention an inner query which says select address code from office where country is India, right? So based, so if the condition matches, then automatically this query will be executed and then we'll get the output. So this was about nested queries, guys. So now what I'll do is I'll now explain you a little bit more concepts and then I'll shift back to my PG admin to show you how you can write nested queries and implement various other queries. So on that note, next let's look into what are set operations. Now, all of you might be knowing what are set operations, right? It's basically union, intersect, and minus. For example, let's say, you know, you have set A and set B. Now, if you perform the union operation between set A and set B, what you'll get is you'll basically get all the data present in both set A and set B. Coming to the intersect option, basically, if you have set A and set B, and then if you perform the intersect operation between both these sets, What you'll get is only those rows which are common in both the queries. And finally, coming to minus, that is, you can basically mention minus or except, right? So for example, let's say you have set A and set B, and then you mention set A minus set B. You basically keep all the rows from the left query which are not included in the right query. Now the vice versa is also true. For example, if you do set B minus set A, then you keep all the queries from the right query which are not included in the left query. So that's how basically you can perform set operations, guys. So in the matter of database management systems, if you have to understand, then you can understand set A and set B as left query and right query. So as you can see from the pictorial representation over here, if you do union, then you get all the rows from both the queries. If you do intersect, then you get only those rows which are common in both the queries. And then if you perform the minus operation or the except operation, you get only the rows from the left query which are not included in the right query, or maybe only those rows which are included in the right query but maybe not included in the left query, right? So guys, that was about set operations. So now let's move forward and let's look into special operators. So when I say special operators, there's nothing much big deal about it. They're just few operators which are special, like, you know, between, is, null, in, exist, all and any. So these are various operators. This is not something that you need to learn in depth, but as you write queries, you should have an idea about all these operators. So when you say between operator, what I mean by between operator is basically that we want to mention a condition between A and B. So whatever values which satisfy the condition between A and B, all those values rows will be printed. Similarly, is null. So the is null operator is basically used to test for the null values. Now, since, you know, it is not possible to test the null values with comparison operators like greater than or less than, we can simply use is null and is not null operators instead. So what you can simply do is you can just find out where, if address is null, or maybe if the date of birth is null and so on. Coming to like operator, the like operator is basically used to get the data of all those values which either start with a character, specific character that you mention, or maybe end with a specific character that you mention. Or it could also happen that, you know, you have few spaces and then you mention a specific character. You also want all those rows. Coming to in operator, this is basically a shorthand operator for multiple OR conditions, which allows you to specify multiple values in where clause. So this is basically used when you want to use nested queries, right? Coming to exist operator is basically used to test if a record exists or not. If it exists, it's fine. If it doesn't exist, then it returns an output that, you know, the query not found. And finally, coming to the all operator is used with a where or a having clause and returns true if all the subquery values meet the condition. So this was about all operator. Coming to any operator, the any operator is also used with the where and the having clauses and returns true if any of the subquery values meet the condition. Apart from that, over here, I also want to tell you about the order by, group by, and the having clauses. So the order by is basically to order the data that you want in a specific format. Let's say, you know, ascending order, descending order, and so on. The group by is basically you want to group the data according to some specific column and so on. Right? And having is basically where you're checking, let's say, you know, having salary greater than 25,000. So only those tuples will be returned whose salary is greater than 25,000. So guys, that was about group by, order by, and having clauses also. Now let's move forward with the next one, that is aggregate functions. So aggregate functions is also one of the most simple topics. So aggregate functions is mainly used with the nested queries, that is basically the min, max, the count, average, and sum. So the min function is basically used to return the smallest value of the selected column in a table. The max function is basically used to return the largest value of the selected column in a table. The count function is basically used to count the number of rows that match a specified criteria. The average function returns the average value of a numeric column that you choose. And the sum function returns the total sum of a numeric column that you choose. Now that was about aggregate functions, guys. So don't worry, I'm just brushing you with the topics, basically the concepts. I'm going to show you how you can use all these concepts based on the queries that I'll execute on the PG admin in a while. Now, but before that, let me just take you through the limit, offset, and fetch values. So the limit is basically used to limit the number of data that you want to get. Now we want only the data of the first 5 rows. So what we'll do is we'll basically mention select star from employee limit 5. What will happen is automatically we'll see the first 5 tuples. Coming to offset, offset is used to basically select a specific number of rows after the limit, right? For example, let's say after the 5th row, we want 3 rows, right? So what we'll do is we'll use the offset statement to basically mention that, you know, after the 5th row, we want 3 rows, right? So basically only after the 5th tuple is read, automatically 6, 7, 8 will be printed out as an output. Coming to fetch, fetch is also one of the ways to limiting the query results, right? So whenever you want to fetch, let's say first 5 rows only, or maybe let's say 10 rows only, then you can use the fetch statement. So I'm going to show you how that's done. Let me just shift back to my PG admin. And now what I'll do is, I'll start with the first topic that I had discussed over here, that is nested queries. So let's write some interesting nested queries so that you get a hands-on experience on how you can integrate into a complex queries, right? So for example, let's say, you know, we want to make a list of all the project numbers for projects that involve an employee whose last name is Smith, either as a worker or as a manager of the department that controls the project. So our main question is basically to list the project numbers for projects that involve the employee Smith. Now that particular employee can either be the manager or can also be the worker of that particular department and controls the project. So to do that, what I'll do is I'll have to write a nested query. So the reason for nested query is simple. That is because, you know, we have to first find out all the projects where, you know, Smith is working as an employee. Later on, we'll find out the projects where Smith is working as a manager, right? So let's start with Smith working as a manager. So for that, what we'll do is we'll type in select distinct because we want unique records. And let's say P number, that is basically the project number from project. And then we also want the department because we're going to use a department table. And then we mention employee because we're going to use the last name, where we'll mention DNUM is equal to the number and MGR SSN is equal to SSN. Also, my last name should be Smith, right? So I'll mention last name is equal to, right? So let me just remove this, put in over here, and let me put a bracket. Now, let me tell you one thing over here. This is not the end to the query because we also want to find out all the project numbers where employee Smith is working as a worker, right? So for that, what we'll do is we'll use the set operation union, right? So because this makes sense, right? We want all the values from set A, and then we also want all the values from set B. So that is the reason we'll use the union operation, and then we'll mention select distinct P number from project works on employee where P number is equal to P number. That is basically the project number from the project table and the works on table, and employee SSN from the works on table to SSN from the employee table. Apart from that, we also have to mention that last name should be Smith, right? So we'll mention and L name is equal to Smith, right? So I'll end it with a semicolon, and let me just remove this typo over here. And then let's execute this particular query. All right, it says department. Oh yes, there's a spelling mistake over here, right? And now let's execute again. So once I execute, you see that, you know, I get the project number 12. That means that, you know, the person with the last name Smith works as a manager or maybe works as a worker in these two projects, that is project number 1 and 2. So guys, this was a nested query with the union operation. Now let's say, you know, you don't want to use any set operations, and let's say you just want to write a simple query. Let's take an example for that. Now, let's say, you know, we want to retrieve the name of employees who have no dependents, right? So we had a relationship which says employees have dependents, right? So let's say, you know, we want the name of employees who have no dependents. So for that, what you can do is you can just type in the query, select first name. Let's say we take first name, and let's say we take last name from employee where we'll mention not. I'm sorry, I have to correct the spelling of where over here. We'll mention not exist, and then I'll again mention a subquery which says select star from dependent where we have to match the SSN, right? So SSN is equal to ESSN, right? So I'll just execute this particular query. And then once we execute this particular query, you'll see an output of all those employees who have no dependents. So that's how, guys, basically you can use this operator of not exist. What I've done is I've basically taken the operator of exist. So if it exists, what will happen is that initially the subquery will be executed with say select star from dependent where SSN is equal to ESSN. So this query will generate all those results which have the dependents, right? So basically all those employees who have dependents, that particular result will be generated over here. Then I put a not condition before that. So when I put a not condition, the output gets reversed. And automatically, I got that output printed. So if you just mention exists over here, and then if you remove not, and then again, if you just execute this particular statement, you'll see a different output. So this is basically the output of all the employees who have dependents. So now let's take this query further and let's say we want to find out the names of those managers who have at least one dependent. So what I'll mention over here is I'll mention select first name, last name from employee where exist, and then I'll change this condition. Select star from dependent where SSN is equal to ESSN, and also I have to take this condition further which says and exist, and then I again have a nested subquery which says select star from department, because we are considering manager, right, where SSN is equal to MGR SSN. So I'll just close this bracket over here and then I'll remove one bracket at the end and let me put an enter so that's clear to you. So what I'm basically doing is I'm basically listing the name of managers who have at least one dependent. So for that, what I've done is I've used an outer query, which has a subquery, and underneath that, I again have another subquery. So for that, what I'm using is select first name, last name from employee where exist, and then again, I have a subquery which says select star from dependent where, you know, SSN is equal to ESSN. This will basically give the output of all the employees who have dependents. Now, after that, we also have to match from select star from department where SSN is equal to MGR SSN, which is basically the name of managers that we want. After that, we're taking dependents into account and then we are returning the first name and the last name. So if you see the output, we get Franklin and Jennifer, right? So Franklin and Jennifer are those managers who at least have one dependent. So guys, that was about exist and not exist, how you can use and all. Now let's move a little bit further. And as I was talking about operators, like the special operators, let's look into few queries related to that. So let me just press on enter over here so that I can make the screen clear for you. Now let's say over here we want to retrieve all the employees whose address is in Houston, Texas. So it's really simple. What I can do is I can just generate select SSN and first name from employee where address like, and then in quotes I'll mention percentage Houston and percentage. And then what I'll do is I'll end with a semicolon over here. So basically I'm generating the SSN and the first name of all the employees whose address is in Houston, Texas, right? So let me just execute it. So once I execute, you see an error that, you know, where address. Okay, so that is basically because our spelling is incorrect over here. So let me just execute again. So once I execute, you see SSN and first name of all those employees whose address is in Houston, Texas, right? So if you want to check this information, you can go back to our employee table and then you can check the information for sure. So that's basically how you can use the like operator. Now let's say, you know, we want to find out all those employees whose first name has, let's say, 5 characters. So if you want to mention 5 characters, how will you do that? Any 5 characters, not necessarily that, you know, it has to start with F or S or A or any other character. It can be any character that you wish to, right? So in that scenario, let's just generate select first name. And let's say I again generate SSN from employee where first name like, okay, there's a typo over here, and then I'll mention 5 characters, right? And then I'll end with a semicolon. So let's just execute this particular query and you'll see that, you know, it's just Joyce, Ahmed and James who have first name with 5 characters. So all the other employees who have first name with any other number of characters are not taken into account. So that's how basically you can use the like operator, guys. Now let's say, you know, you want to use the between operator. For example, let's say, you know, we want to find out all those employees whose salary lies between, let's say, 30,000 to 45,000. So for that, I'll type in the statement select star from employee where, and then you mention the nested query salary between, and then you mention 30,000. Right, and 40,000, right? And so let me just execute this particular query. All right, once I execute this particular query, you get the information of all those employees whose salary lies between 30,000 to 40,000. So guys, that's how you can use the between operator. Now, as I'm talking about operators, let me just show you a simple functionality of the arithmetic operator also. Let's say, you know, we want to show the resulting salaries of each and every employee working on the product Y project. And let's say, you know, it's given a 20% raise. So to do that, what you can do is you can write a query. Let's say select E dot F name. So if you remember, I used a similar query previously also. and then I choose E dot L name, and then I mention 1.2, right, into, that is basically my arithmetic operator that I'm using, and I'm choosing E dot salary as let's say increased salary from, I'm choosing employee table because salary is an employee table, and then since I'm using E dot F name, I'll mention employee as E, and then works on W, and project as P, and further what I'll do is I'll mention where employee.ssn is equal to the works.ssn, right? So whatever employee is working on product Y, right? So that's what we want to find out over here. So he has to first satisfy the condition of the SSNs have to match. Apart from that, we'll consider and, all right, this has to be ESSN, right? And then I'll mention work.pNumber is equal to p.pNumber and p.pName is equal to product Y. So let me just end this particular query over here and now execute it. Once I execute, you'll see that, you know, we get the first name and the last name and the increased salaries of all those employees who have worked on product Y, and their salary is increased by 20%. So that's how, guys, basically you can use the as operator and also arithmetic operators together. Now, as I was talking about one more operator, that is null. So if I have to talk about is null, let's say, you know, we want to find out all those employees who do not have any supervisor. So then directly you will use is null operator. So in that scenario, what you'll basically do is you'll write a query like, you know, select, let's say, star from employee where super SSN is null. I'm basically using this is null operator to find out all those employees who do not have any supervisors. So I'll just execute this. And then once I execute this, you get the details of that particular employee who doesn't have a supervisor. So guys, that was about operators and all. I won't go into each and every operator now. I'm leaving the rest to you so that you practice. So next, let's look into how you can use aggregate functions in SQL. So to use aggregate functions, what you can simply do is you basically have to use the functions as sum, max, min, average, and count, right? For example, let's say, you know, we want to find out the sum, the max, the min, and the average salary from employee. Let's say, you know, I want to find out the sum, min, max of salary from employee, right? So I'll just mention select sum, salary, min, salary, max, salary from employee, right? So when I mention that, you'll see that, you know, the sum is so much, the minimum and the maximum is so much, right? That was about sum, min, max. Now let's say, you know, I want to count the salary. So what I'll do is I'll basically change this particular function to count, right? And then I'll say count distinct salary because I want to count the unique ones, right? And then I'll mention from employee, right? So I'll just remove this particular section, right? And then if I just execute this, you'll see an output of 7, right? So basically we have 7 distinct salaries. So that was about aggregate functions, guys. Now next, let's look into order by, group by, and having clauses. So as I mentioned before, the order by is basically used to get the output either in the ascending format or the descending format. The group by is basically used to group the data that you want by a specific column, and having is basically used to check a condition. Let's say we want to write a query to retrieve a list of employees and the projects they're working on, ordered by the department, and within each department, they have to be ordered alphabetically by the last name and then the first name. So initially they have to be ordered by department, and then under each department also they have to be further ordered by the last name and the first name. So to do that, what you can do is you can just mention select, and then you mention D dot D name, right? And then you mention E dot L name. We also want the first name, right? So we'll mention E dot F name, and then P dot P name from department. There's a typo. And then we also want employee. We also want works on, right? Now over here we have to mention as W over here, as E over here, as D over here, and then I forgot to mention the project. So project as P. And then you have to mention the condition, which says where D dot D number is equal to E dot D number and employee dot SSN is equal to works on dot SSN and works on dot p number is equal to p dot p number, and then it is order by d dot d name, and then I mention e dot l name and e dot f name, right? And then if I just end this particular query, let's execute this particular query. You see an error that, you know, w.ssn not found, because this has to be ESSN, right? So I'll have to mention ESSN over here. And then let's execute this query again. It's a typo error again, which says p.p number. Right, now let's execute again, and you see an output of D name, L name, F name, and project name. So initially, if you see, the D name is ordered by alphabetically, that is in the ascending order from A to R. And then under administration, Wallace and Jennifer have come. Similarly, headquarters have Borg and James. Research has a lot of values, but underneath that also, we have ordered them according to ascending order, by which I mean that, you know, it is ordered alphabetically by last name and then the first name. So that's how basically, guys, you can use the order by. Now, this was a little bit complicated one. If I just have to explain you with simple one, what you can do is you can consider the query of, let's say, you know, we want to find out the salary of all the employees in a descending order. So what we do is we just type in select star from employee order by, and then we mention salary descending order. Right, now if I just execute this particular query, you'll see that, you know, we get all the details of all the employees in the salaries of the descending orders. So in the case of descending, if you mention ascending, then you'll get an output of all the details of all the employees in an ascending order of, based on the salaries. So guys, that was about the order by clause. Now let's move forward with the group by clause. Now let's say, you know, we want to find out for each department, we want to retrieve the department number and the number of employees in the department, right? So now to retrieve the number of employees, you know, the aggregate function, we have to use the count function. And then we want to group it by the department number, right? Because we have to do it for each department, right? The question says for each department, we want to retrieve the department number and the number of employees. So to do that, what I'll simply do is I'll mention a select query department number and then a count function of all the employees. And then I'll mention from employee, right? So let me just press on enter so that the keyboard doesn't move. And then I mention group by D number, right? Because we want to find it for each department. We're using this. So for each department, we have a count, like, you know, in the department number 5, the number of employees working are 4. In the department number 4, the number of employees working at 4 are 3. And in the department 1, the number of employees working are 1. All right. So that was about the group by clause, guys. I hope that was simple to understand. Now let's look into the having clause. So having, as I mentioned before, is basically used to specify a specific condition. So let's say, you know, having count less than 2, greater than 2, having salary greater than 25,000 or maybe less than 30,000 and so on. Now let's say, you know, we have a scenario where we want to retrieve the data for each project on which, let's say, more than 3 employees work. We want to retrieve the project number and the number of employees who work on the project. Our main condition is that, you know, for each project, where the employee count is more than 3, right? So for that, what I'm going to do is I'm going to mention the condition select P number, that is because of the project number. And then let's say I want to count the employees, right? So I'll mention count star from project works on where P number is equal to P number. And then I group by for each project, right? So when you group by, you basically have to group by project number, and then I mentioned the condition having count greater than, I forgot to mention the asterisk condition over here, 3. So basically I'm mentioning the condition that, you know, we want to retrieve the project number and the count of employees who are working on the project, where the project number from the project table matches the project number from the works on table, and then it is grouped by project number where the count is more than 3. Now, if I execute this particular query, you see that, you know, there's no data returned, right? So that may be because, you know, the condition is not satisfied by any of the data that we have. So let's say, you know, we want to do it 2. So I'm just mentioning the condition to be 2 and I click on enter. And then you see that, you know, we get the project number 2 where you see the count is 3, and then the project number 20 where you see the count is 3. So initially when I mentioned the condition having count greater than 3, the output did not come because there was no such data present. So that's the reason there was nothing returned. But when we change the condition, you see that, you know, we get an output of two project numbers. So guys, that's how basically you can use the group by clause, the order by clause and the having clause. Next, as I was talking about the limit, offset and fetch, let me just quickly cover that particular part so that we can go back and learn about SQL joins. Now, talking about a limit, as I told you, if you want to limit the data that you want to fetch, right? So basically, let's say, you know, we want to just fetch 5 rows, right? What you can simply do is you can just type in select star from, let's say, works on, and then we limit 5, right? And now if I execute this particular query, you'll see an output that, you know, only 5 rows of data will be printed out. So that's because, you know, we're limiting the data that has to be written. Now, let's say, you know, we want to select 3 rows from, let's say, works on table after the 5th row. So we want the next 3 rows to be printed after the 5th row. So for that, you have to use the offset statement. So what you'll do is you'll mention select star from works on, and then what you'll do is instead of limit over here, you'll mention offset 5, and then over here you'll mention limit 3. So after the 5th row, you want 3 rows to be printed. So that is the reason you'll mention offset 5 and limit 3. So let me just execute this particular query. So if I execute this particular query, you'll see that, you know, I've got the output of 6th, 7th and 8th row. So basically, guys, that's how you can use the offset statement. Now, let's say, you know, if you want to use the fetch statement. So as I mentioned before, the fetch statement is also used to fetch the records. So let's say, you know, I want to fetch the first 8 rows. So what I'll do is I'll mention select star from works on and then mention offset 5. And then I'll mention first 8 rows only. So after the 5th row, what I'll mention is I'll mention select star from works on and then I'll mention fetch first 8 rows only, right? So if I just execute this particular statement, you'll see the first 8 rows. So over here, you can clearly see the output that, you know, when we used limit 5, you saw the first 5 rows. And then when we used offset 5 and then limit 3, we saw the next 3 rows. And now if you're using the fetch command where we say fetch first 8 rows only, you'll see that, you know, we fetch all the 8 rows, right? So that's how, guys, basically you can use the limit, offset and the fetch commands. So that was about till now. Now let's go back to our PPT and next let's look into joins in SQL. So all of you might be knowing what are joins, right? Now joins in SQL are commands which are basically used to combine rows from two or more tables based on a related column between those two tables. So they're predominantly used when a user is trying to extract data from the tables which have one to many relationships or many to many relationships between them. So if you just have to understand joins in a simple language, then joins in SQL are basic commands which are used to combine rows from two or more tables based on a related column between those two tables. So basically there are four types of joins present, that is the inner join, the left join, the right join and the full join. So as you can see on my screen, the inner join is the join which is used to return the records which have matching values in both the tables. So whenever you have matching values in both the tables, you use inner join. Coming to the left join returns records from the left table and also those records which satisfy the condition from the right table. The right join returns records from the right table and also those records which satisfy the condition from the left table. And finally, coming to full join, the full join returns all those records which either have a matching value in the left table or on the right table. So guys, these were the mainly four types of joins, that is the inner join, the full, the left and the right join. Now let me just quickly take you back to PG admin and then let's apply a few joins on the tables that we have. For example, let's say, you know, we want to apply left join, right? As I told you before, the left join is basically going to return all those records from the left table and also all those records matching the condition from the right table. What I'll do is I'll mention select, let's say SSN, I'm going to mention first name and then I mention dependent dot dependent name. And then I'll mention dependent dot relationship, which is a column of the dependent table. And then I'll mention from employee left join. And then I'll mention the table one that is basically dependent on employee dot SSN is equal to dependent dot ESSN. So when I execute this particular query, you see an error that, you know, the table is not found because we have an error with the column name. So let's just check the column name. Okay, it's underscore. So I'll mention underscore over here. So when you see the output, you can clearly see that, you know, we've got all the records from the left table, that is a dependent table, and then all the records which also match the condition from the right table. So that's how, guys, you can apply left join. Now similarly, you can apply right join also. So for the same condition, let's apply the right join and let's see the difference in the outputs, right? So what I'll do is I'll just scroll again and then I'll just change it to right join. And now I'll execute again. So let me just execute this particular query. And once I execute this particular query, you'll see a difference, right? So that's basically how you can play around with joins, guys. This was about left and right. Now, before I conclude the joins part, let me also talk about the inner join and the full join. So the inner join is basically where you have matching values in both tables, right? So let's say, you know, we select SSN and first name, and let's say, you know, we remove this particular section and then we mention from employee. I'll mention inner join dependent on employee.ssn is equal to dependent. So we'll get all those records which have matching values in both the tables, right? I'll execute this particular query and you'll see the output, right? So these are basically all those values which have a matching values in both the table A and table B. And finally, let's say, you know, if I want to specify the full join, which basically will give me the output of all those records which either have a matching value in the left table or on the right table, what I can do is I can simply mention full join over here. And then I execute this and then you'll see an output like this, right? So basically you'll see that, you know, these are all the tuples which have either a matching value in the left table or on the right table. So guys, that was about joins. Next in this session, let's move forward and take a look at the views. So views are really simple, guys. As the name suggests, views in SQL is a single table which is derived basically from the other tables. So for instance, if you consider the example on my screen, I have two tables, right? Now, for example, let's say I want to create a new view, which will basically have few columns or rows from a specific table and few columns or rows from the other table, right? So that is basically my view. So now views are used in industries to basically collaborate with the data of many tables so that the company can understand how to go about the next action step they should take while taking any specific decision. So without wasting any further time, let's take a look at how we can create a view. So to create a view, it's really simple. Either you can use the query tool, or what you can do is you can just go to the view option, right click over here, choose create and choose view. Since I'm writing queries for all of them, I'll show you by writing queries itself. Else you can use this option also. So talking about views. So to create a view, it's really simple. As you create a table, you can similarly create a view, like, you know, create view. And then you mention the view name. Let's say we're going to create a view for the works on table. So I'll mention works on one. And then what I'll do is I'll mention the condition. So if you stop over here, this will simply create a view and this will not store any particular data that you want. But if you start mentioning the condition, then it will have all the data according to the condition that you've mentioned, right? So over here, what I'm doing is I'm going to mention the details of an employee who work on a specific project. So for that, I'm going to do is I'm going to just create a view over here. So as I'm creating, so I'll type in create view works on, and then I'll mention the condition as select first name, last name and project name from employee project and works on where SSN is equal to ESSN and project number is equal to project number, right? So that is basically the project number matching from the project table to the works on table and the SSN matching from the employee table to the works on table, right? And then I'll just execute this particular query. Right, once you execute this particular query, you see an output that, you know, query returns successfully. Now, if I just refresh this particular views, you'll see a view named as works on with the columns that you've mentioned, that is first name, last name, and the project name. Now, if you want to see the data present in this particular view, what you can do is you can just mention select star from, and then you mention the view name, that is works on one, right? And then if I execute this, you'll see the output, right? So that is basically the data that is automatically present in our view. And the view is created by deriving data from other tables like the employee table, the project table, and the works on table. So that's how, guys, basically you can create a view. Now, let's say, you know, you want to drop a view. Dropping a view is also really simple, guys. You have to type in drop view and then the view name, right? So if I mention works on one, and then if I end with a semicolon, you'll see that, you know, the drop view is successful. So if I just refresh this particular section, you'll see that, you know, there's no view available. So guys, that's how basically you can drop a view also. So guys, that was all about views. I'm not going to go into depth of how you can create more complicated views and all, because I've given you a basic understanding of how views are created and how you can drop the views also. Rest, I leave it to you to practice. Please remember the fact that, you know, I'm just giving you all the basic concepts so that you get started with PostgreSQL. But if you have to get a good understanding of all the databases, then make sure you have good practice. On that note, let's get started with the next topic for today's session, that is procedures. So procedures are basically a section of code. So basically you can understand procedures as a section of code or functions which you can save, you know, and then you can reuse it, right? So whenever you want to save a section of code or maybe a function and then you want to keep reusing it, that's where stored procedures come into the picture. So for example, let's say, you know, you want to create procedures, right? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a new table. Let's stop with the example of employees and works-ons and so on. Let's move on with a new example. Let's say, you know, I create two tables. So I'll mention create table and then I'll mention, let's say the table name, table first table to be TBL1, and then I'll mention the column to be TBL1 ID and then let it be int. Now similarly, I'll create another table also. So let me just change it to TBL2 also. And then now what I'll do is I'll just execute this particular two statements, right? So if I just refresh this section over here, right? So now you will see that, you know, instead of six tables, now there are eight tables. So let me just minimize the others so that you have no confusion. Right, so we have two tables, that is TBL1 and TBL2. Now let's say, you know, you want to create a procedure such that, you know, you want to insert values. So basically, I don't want to write insert into statements 110 times. What I'm going to do is I'm going to just create a simple function through which you can insert values. So to insert values, what you can simply do is I'll mention create procedure. And then let's say I mention the procedure name to be insert values. And now let's say, you know, we mention what values have to be inserted. Let's say, you know, value X has to be inserted in table 1 and value Y has to be inserted in table 2. So I'll mention X integer and Y integer. And then what I'll do is I'll mention language SQL because it is a form of SQL as $. And then I'll mention insert into TBL1. That is basically my first table, values x, right? And then I'll mention insert into TBL2 values y. After that, I'll just end this section with $ and semicolon. And then what I'll do is I'll basically call this particular function. So this is basically how you create a procedure. But yes, if you want to reuse a procedure, then you have to call that particular procedure, right? So for that, I'll use the function call insert values and then I'll mention, let's say, 1, 2, right? So these are basically the two values that I want to mention in table 1 and table 2. So the table 1 should be inserted with value 1 and then table 2 should have the value 2. And now what I'll do is I'll execute this particular section completely. Once I execute this particular section completely, you'll see an output that, you know, call query has been returned successfully, right? Now let's just use the select statement to see whether, you know, the value has been inserted or not. So let's say I'll mention select star from table 1. And then similarly, I'll mention select star from table 2. So if I just print select star from table 1, you see the value to be 1, right? I hope that you can see. Now, if I mention select star from table 2, you'll see the value to be 2. So that means our values have got inserted. So guys, this is a really simple example. I've just taken two tables with a single column. Now you can have any number of columns and then you can mention any number of columns to be present over here. And then you mention the specific values into the insert statements. And then what you just have to do is you just have to keep changing the values over here. So for example, let's say if I do 3, 4 over here again, and then I execute the statement call insert values. And then let's say, you know, I execute the statement select star from TBL1. So you'll see that, you know, apart from 1, we also have the value 3. Now similarly, if I do select star from TBL2, you'll see the output that, you know, apart from 2, we also have 4. So that's how basically, guys, you can create stored procedures. Well, I think it was really simple to understand how you can create procedures and so on, right? Now in this session, let's move forward with the next topic, that is triggers. Now triggers are a set of SQL statements which are stored in the database catalog. Now these statements are executed whenever an event associated with the table occurs. So a trigger is basically invoked either before or after the data is changed by either the insert statement, the update statement, or the delete statement. And it only invokes whenever there's an event associated with the table. So now let's look into how you can implement triggers in PostgreSQL. So to implement triggers, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a table first. So let's say I create a table audit. And then let's say, you know, I'm going to consider employee ID right? To be of char type and 9 characters, since our SSN is of 9 characters, and then it should not be null. And then apart from that, I am also going to consider, let's say, you know, we have entry date, right? Let's say joining date or maybe entry date. And then we have text. It's of text data type, right? And there should not be any space because date is also a data type. And then I'll mention not null. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a function, and then I'm going to create a function which returns a trigger as a specific trigger. And then I'll use that particular trigger on the employee table. So let's do the same. Now, once I create this table audit, what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a function audit log function, which will basically return a trigger as example table, which will begin whenever you wish to insert something into the audit table. Now, the trigger example table will be created then. So let's just do the same. So now, since I've created the table audit, let me create the function, right? So to create a function, you have to type in create or replace function audit log func. That is basically, you know, the function name that I'm giving. And then I mention returns trigger as, and then I'll mention the trigger name. Let it be example table, right? And then I'll mention begin. Right, so it will begin then, and then I'll mention insert into audit where emp id and entry date will be mentioned and values will be new.ssn. A new SSN will be generated, and then automatically the current timestamp will be taken as the entry date, right? So that's how basically you can also use timestamps also, guys. So basically what I'm doing is whatever is the current time, I'm using that particular current timestamp. So I'll mention timestamp. And then what I'll do is I'll mention return new and then end. So this is basically the function that I'm creating. So the function basically says that, you know, it will return a trigger as example table whenever you want to insert something into the audit table. Now, as I was talking about the trigger example table, we have to create that also, right? Now, before that, I forgot to mention something over here. That is, you know, you have to mention example table. That is basically in language PSQL, right? So you'll have to mention that particular fact over here. Now, after that, if you wish to create a trigger, you'll mention create trigger. We'll mention example trigger after insert on, basically whenever you're inserting employee for each row, I'm going to execute the procedure or the function that I just created. So that is basically my audit log function. So I'll just copy from here, paste it over here. And then finally, I'll mention the insert statement. So what I'm going to do is the insert, since we are doing on the employee table itself, I'll just copy this particular fact over here. And then what I'll do is I'll paste it over here. And let's say I mention Sahithi. Let's say L, and then I mention Kapagantula, and let's say I randomly put in details, right? And then let's say I change the salary also so that there's no redundancy anywhere, right? So what have I done over here? I've basically created a table audit. So this audit table is basically like, you know, whenever I want to insert into the employee table, a trigger will be created. So basically a trigger will be invoked, which says after execute on, you have to mention the procedure, right? So basically the procedure is basically the function that we created. That's basically it returns to the trigger example table where, you know, it inserts into the audit table automatically. That is basically the employee ID that I've mentioned over here, and automatically the current timestamp as the entry date. So let's see what happens. So what I'll do is I'll execute from here to here, and let's just check if everything is selected. Yes. And then I execute. All right, it says syntax error at employee ID value current. Oh, it's because the current timestamp spelling is wrong over there. So let's just correct that. Now I'll again execute this particular section again. It still says that, you know, there's an error over here. Yes, that's because, you know, I've missed comma over here, and then I had put the brackets. So I have to remove the brackets and then I have to put the comma. And then again, let's try executing this particular section. It says that, you know, the key super SSN is not present in the table employee, right? So that's because we cannot randomly do, and we have foreign keys present. So let's just randomly choose any super assistant. Let's say 333, 444 times 5, right? And now I'll go back and now let's execute again. Once I execute again, you can clearly see an output that, you know, query returned successfully, right? So let me just refresh tables and let me just refresh triggers. So once I refresh tables, you'll see that, you know, there's an employee table. And then we also see there's an audit table, and the audit table has the columns employee ID and entry date, right? And then we have a trigger function which says audit log function is basically the trigger function that we just created. Now, if I wanted to see the data from the audit table, I'll just choose select star from audit. And then you'll see automatically the employee ID and the date, which is basically the current time, is generated. So that's how, guys, basically you can use triggers. So with this, we come to an end of the data manipulation commands. I hope you've understood all the commands and the syntaxes and the statements that I just showed you. Now let's move forward with the next set of statements, that is the data control language commands. Now the data control language commands, as I previously mentioned in the starting of the session, is basically used to provide rights and privileges to the users to access database, views, tables, and so on. So basically, there are only two statements that you need to understand in this particular section, that is the grant statement and the revoke statement. So let's consider the grant statement. So the grant command is basically used to grant privileges to the databases or tables. For example, let's say, you know, we consider the table one we created over here. So if I right click over here and go to properties, and let's say I go to securities, you see that, you know, there's no grantee privileges. There's nothing present over here because there are no privileges granted to this particular table. So let's grant permissions to this particular table. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to type in grant select on. Then I'll mention the table name, that is table 1, 2, and I'll mention public. And then I'll just execute this particular query. You'll see that, you know, the query has been returned successfully. And now what I'll do is I'll right click over here, go to properties, and then go to parameters, and then go to security over here. And then you'll see that, you know, automatically we have granted a public privilege to this particular table. Now let's say, you know, we want to grant privileges on basically the command insert on, right? So whenever there's some insert on, we want to grant privileges to the public. So anybody can insert into this particular table. Now let's say, you know, we want to grant insert on privileges to the employee table, right? So basically anybody can insert into this particular table. So that is basically grant insert on employee to public. If I just execute, you'll see the output of query returned successfully, right? So now what I'll do is I'll just go to my employee table over here. Go to properties, go to security, and you'll see public, and then you'll see privileges of A, right? Basically all. So that's how basically you can grant privileges, guys. Now you can also revoke back your privileges. Let's say, you know, you want to revoke back the privilege that you just gave. So for that, you just have to use the statement revoke, right? So you'll type in revoke insert on employee, and then instead of to, you'll mention from. So you'll mention revoke insert on employee from public, right? So you'll just execute this particular query. And then we'll go to properties again over here, go to security, and then you'll see that, you know, there's no more public privilege present over here. So guys, that's how basically you can control privileges and rights for your databases and tables. So guys, that was about data control language commands. Now moving forward, the next type of commands that we have is the transaction control language commands. So the transaction control language commands come into the picture when you want to make sure that, you know, the transaction in the database is meeting all the standards, that is basically the asset properties. So asset properties are basically atomicity, consistency, isolation, and durability. So basically, if you want to make sure that, you know, your database is making sure that the transaction properties are met, then you have to use this transaction control language commands. So to use transaction language control commands, what I'm going to do is I'm going to perform transaction on table one, right? So let me just see what values are present in table one. So let me just see. I forgot to mention from over here. So it's select star from table 1, and then you see 1, 3, right? Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to insert around values till 10. So let's insert all the other values. I'm just going to copy it from my doc over here. So since I have already 1 and 3 values present over here, what I'm going to do is I'm not going to insert these values. So I'll just remove these and then I'll just execute them, right? So you'll see that, you know, data has been inserted into my table. Now let's begin a transaction. When I say begin a transaction, you have to use the syntax known as begin. So you'll type in begin, and then let's say, you know, we want to delete all the values which have the ID greater than 5, right? So basically all the tuple values which have the ID greater than 5 have to be deleted. So for that, we're initializing a transaction, and then I'll mention delete from and table one, where table one ID. So let me just check the column name. That's TBL one ID is greater than 5. So I'll mention begin. So basically my transaction will begin, and then what I'll do is I'll delete. So let's just do that, right? So you can see that, you know, the transaction is running on, and then we have deleted till 5. Now let's say, you know, if I want to rollback is basically I don't want it to occur, right? So when I hit on rollback, you'll see that, you know, automatically all the 10 values will come back, right? So if I just use the syntax of select star from table one, you'll see the output of 1 to 10 again. So what you should understand from over here is basically that, you know, the begin is basically used to begin the transaction, and the rollback is basically used to roll back from the previous transaction. So over here, what I've done is that I started the transaction and then I deleted the values greater than 5. So all the values got deleted. Now when I hit on rollback, what happened is that, you know, the transaction got rolled back and automatically all the values got retrieved. So that's how basically you can do rollback. Now similarly, you can do commit, right? So what I can do now is I can type on commit over here, and then I can begin a transaction again, right? So once I begin a transaction again, and once I delete all the values greater than 5, and then when I hit on commit, you cannot roll back, right? So all the values will be deleted whose IDs will be greater than 5. So if I just execute this particular statement, you'll see that, you know, you only have 1 to 5 values. Now similarly, you can also abort the transaction using the statement abort. So guys, that was all about transaction language control commands. Now let's move forward with the next topic, that is how you can export and import data. Well guys, exporting and importing data is really simple. For example, let's say, you know, I want to export and import data of the table one values, right? So what I'll do is I'll right click over here and then go to import export option. And then what I'll do is I'll mention the file name, right? So basically I'm exporting, and I'll search for, let's say, demo.csv, right? So now demo.csv is present in my E folder, right? I'll choose that, and then I'll click on create. Once I click on create, you'll see that, you know, if I want to replace, well, I have a pre-existing file, so I'm just allowing it to replace. Well, you can do that, right? And then you'll click on OK. Once you click on OK, you'll automatically see that, you know, the details have been copied, right? So what I'll do is I'll go over here, go to E folder mine, and go to demo.csv. So in the demo.csv, you can see that, you know, we've got the data 1 to 5 because we just had one row column, that is 1 to 5, and we just deleted the other values. So that's how, guys, basically you can also export and import data. It's really simple in PGAdmin. Now, finally, coming to the final topic for today's session, that is the UUID data type. Now, the UUID data type is basically the data type which is based to uniquely identify a particular value, right? For example, as I was talking in employee, I said SSN, right? So for every value, I had to insert an SSN. Basically, I had to insert a value. Maybe if you don't want to do it, what you can do is you can just directly use this particular extension, and then you can directly use that particular value. So now let me just shift back to my PGAdmin. Now let me close this particular part. Let me scroll back. And now let's say, you know, we want to see first what are the available extensions, right? So I'll just type in select star from PG hyphen available extensions. So I'll mention this and I'll click on execute. Once I click on execute, you'll see that, you know, we have name, we have default value, we have installed version, and we have comment, right? So we have a lot of available extensions. But what I want to use is the UUID OSP, right? So if I scroll down more, you'll see this particular one, right? That is UUID OSP. That's what we want to use over here. So initially, if you do not have this extension, what you can do is you can just create this extension. So you'll type in create extension and mention if not exists, and then you'll mention UUID hyphen OSP. So this has to be in single quotes. And then you'll just execute this. So let me just execute this by dragging this down. So it says it's not fine. Oh yes, it has to be in double quotes itself. That was my bad. So when you create extension if not exists UUID OSP, you see an output of, you know, create extension. Now what you can do is you can just directly select from the available extensions. Now once I create the extension, and then if I select UUID generate v4, you'll see that, you know, automatically a new ID is getting generated, right? Now the next time I execute this particular statement again, you'll see that, you know, a different ID will be generated. So that's how basically you can use UUID as a primary key for the table. So for example, in the social security number of employee table, you could have used this. Now in that scenario, you don't have to sit and mention the SSN over there. You can just put the specific function, that is UUID underscore generate underscore V4, and automatically you'll see that, you know, every time you hit the query, you'll see a new ID will be generated, right? So guys, that was all about UUID data type. Now you can use UUID data type as a primary key to uniquely identify your data type. All right, guys. So with this, we come to an end to this session on PostgreSQL tutorial for beginners. I hope you found the session informative. So if you have any further queries related to the session, please comment in the comment section below. Until then, that's all from my side today. Thank you and happy learning.
I hope you have enjoyed listening to this video. Please be kind enough to like it, and you can comment any of your doubts and queries, and we will reply them at the earliest. Do look out for more videos in our playlist and subscribe to EduReka channel to learn more. Happy learning!